Okay, Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. Welcome back in my class Teknologi Pengendalian Hama, Pest Management Technology. And now, we will study about the IPM implementation and good agricultural practices. Yeah, so what is the IPM? You already know in the previous lectures. And can you see in this slide? This is the field, and it's really clean. Do you see the weeds on the field? I think we would not see the weeds on the field because of what? Because of their weed management is really fantastic. They're using high technology. They're using machine. Like in the next slide, you will learn more about in weeding management in integrated pest management. Okay, the first one is integrated pest management. It's an ecosystem-based strategy that focuses on long-term prevention of pests and their damage through a combination of technique such as biological habitat manipulation, modification of culture practices, and use of resistant varieties. Okay, in integrated pest management, we can use several combination of technique. Yeah, we can use cultural, physical, mechanical, biological, and we can use the last option using chemical. Chemical synthetic pesticide. Okay, this is habitat manipulation. What is habitat manipulation? Habitat manipulation is how to make our habitat, how to make our field that is really suitable for the life or natural enemies by we plant a refugia plant. Refugia plant is a plant that it has flowers. They can make that plant that can they can make the flowery plant for shelter of the natural enemies. It is sebagai pelindung dari mereka dapat berlindung di dalam tanaman refugia tersebut ya, tanaman berbunga. Modification of cultural practices. Ya, for example from the tillage, pengolahan lahan, and then how to use fertilizer, water, and other. The aims is suppress pest population below the economic injury level. You study in the previous lectures, you know the graph, and there is an economic injury level. Okay, and in integrated pest management, how we can make sure that the pest is still below. The population of the pest is still below the economic injury level or economic threshold, masih di bawah ambang ekonomi. So that if the population is still below the economic threshold, we still can rely on other management such as cultural, physical, mechanical, and biological. While if the population is excess the economic threshold, we can use the chemical. And okay, this is the definition of IPM from FAO. The careful consideration of all available pest control techniques that discourage the development of pest management, pest population, and keep pesticide and other intervention to the level that are economically justified. That is one of the aims of IPM. So we should make sure that not only the safe for human, but also safe to the environment and safe to the cost. IPM emphasizes the growth of healthy crop. Okay. So in integrated pest management, we should make sure that we plant a healthy crop. We use the resistant variety. We use the good tillage, pengolahan tanah yang bagus, good fertilizing, and etc. So that our crop is healthy. While our crop is healthy, so the crop itself they have the power to combat the pests and diseases in the field. Okay, and then the first one is cultural research, cultural method, pengendalian secara budidaya. Of cultural method of suppressing pest problem in the field include preparing the soil, how we prepare the soil, how is the tillage, choosing plants that are adapted to the site condition. We should use resistant varieties that are not attractive to pests or that are tolerant of insect and disease. For example, this is the variety. Some of the variety in paddy plant, HIPA 11, HIPA 14, and etc. In each variety, there should be their description about the variety itself, from the potency, from the how is the production potency, how many tons per hectare, and how is the height, and also how is the resistance to the pest and disease. For example, in HIPA 11 is susceptible biotype 3, yaitu susceptible to rentan. And then HIPA 14 is more resistant biotype 2. This is about the resistance of the pest, and also in the description of variety there is a description about the disease also. Okay. Rotating crop is also important. Do not only plant, for example, paddy, because if we plant only paddy in all year, so we can the pest population in the field is high in every season, and we should cut the life cycle of that pest by rotating crop. So if we rotate crop from example from paddy and maize and paddy again, so the pest is different. So the life cycle might be disrupted. Mixed cropping. Well, if we mix crop, if we do mixed cropping or polyculture, so the biodiversity is higher. It means the natural enemies should be higher too. And we should know the timing of planting to avoid pests. Managing weeds is a must. How we use seed. Pruning itu pemangkasan ya. And mulch and planting traps crops. In the next slide, we will study about the mulch and the trap crop. What is trap crop? We can see in the next slide. And before we go, this is a video about the managing weeds in Netherlands and in Indonesia. What is the difference? In Indonesia, in the right one, there are a lot of grandmother, they cleaning the field by using tools, by using arit and by hand. And this is a really consuming. And the result, how is the result is there are a lot of weeds left in the field. While in Europe, for example, in Netherlands, as you see in their field, the field is so clean from the weeds. And what they do, they use machine. This machine can operate by itself because it's also they help by GPS. And this is me and my friends. And after they use this machine, and there is a lady here. They make sure there are no weeds left in the field. So they have like a bamboo, and they make sure they clean the leftover weeds in the field. Okay, let's see the video. Okay, please wait. Okay. Okay, they are cleaning the field. And then this machine can operate by itself by using a technology. In integrated pest management, we can combine low technology and high technology. Yeah, look at this machine. There are no operator in there, and still it can work fastly. Okay, it means that the weeding technology is really good. Okay, next to the next slide about the resistant variety. Resistant variety is a must. We should use the resistant variety to make sure our plant is good, and we can suppress the population of pests in the field. This is a brown plant hopper. Brown plant hopper is called urang in Indonesia. This is a short wing. There are two generations, short wing and the macropteran. Macropteran is long wing yang punya sayap panjang. This long wing is produced when the population in a plant is over. So the plant hopper will produce the wing one. What is the purpose of producing the wings brown plant hopper? The purpose is to move from one plant into another plant because of the population is too high. So that long wing can move to another plant. Brown plant hopper nila parvata lugens hemiptera. The mouth part is piercing and sucking delpacidae. Is warang or brown plant hopper is the main pest of paddy plant. and we can found this brown plant hopper near the base of tillage. So you should if you go to the paddy field, please find the brown plant hopper or worang in this area, yeah, in the base of tillage di pangkal batang. And the symptoms is hopper burn. Hopper burn is a symptoms like burned, seperti terbakar ya. Symptoms like a burned. So the color is brown. And this pest also can transmit the virus. Okay, and then next slide. The mulch. Mulch is layer of material applied to the surface of soil. This is one of the cultural measures that we can do. We can use a mulch. There are two kind of mulch: plastic mulch from polyethylene film, and this is inorganic. We can use maybe twice or more in the field. And the organic one is from straw, yeah, jerami. The reason of applying mulch not only conserve the soil moisture, but also improving the fertility and health of the soil. And of course, also the use of a mulch will reduce the population of weeds. The weeds will not able to grow because the soil is covered by mulch. So by using the mulch, the population of weeds will decrease too. Okay, and then this is other research that we can do in the cultural research by using trap crops. What is trap crop? Trap crop is a plant that attract agricultural pests, usually insect, and away from near big crops. For example, main crop tomato, and the outside of tomato crop is sorghum. So the trap crop is usually planted before the main crop. So the trap crop will grow first then the main crop. The aim is the pest will attract to the trap crop first before the main crop, so we can easy to handle the pest, the main pest, and that pest would not attack our main crop, but they will attract the trap crop first. And the trap crop may not harvestable, can save the main crop from pests without the use of pesticide. For example, the using Sesbania rostrata as trap crop in a soybean field, because in a soybean they are pot borer. Pot borer is penggerek polong. And also Sesbania rostrata as a trap crop. So we plant Sesbania rostrata first in the field, and then we plant soybean later. So the pot borer will attract to Sesbania rostrata, then the main crop, the soybean. Okay, I hope you understand what I mean. And another measure is using physical and mechanical measures. Physical pest control is a method of getting rid of pests by killing, removing, and setting up barrier that will prevent destruction of plants. Yeah, is carried out by regulating physical factors that can affect the development of pests. Thus, providing certain conditions that make it difficult for pests to live. It's easy. What is the example of using physical measures, physical control? We can use heat treatment, for example, for seed, cold treatment, a sum of control using sound wave, and silver molds also one of the physical control, and drying rice field to control snail. Yeah, in a paddy field there are snails, and the snails can be reduced by we manage the air, we manage the water in a field by drying. And sticky traps is traps that have many colors, for example yellow, red, but the most attractive is the yellow one. We can find in the next slide. And mechanical control can be in the form of tools or without tools, which used to kill or block the pest. For example, using crop isolation is one of the mechanical control. Crop isolation, like in the pictures, you can see this is the apple orchard in Netherlands, and this is me when I was in an apple orchard in Flevoland, and you see above this there is a netting here, so all of this orchard is covered by netting. This is how they reduce the population of pests. And okay, and other wrapping the fruit in a paper or plastic, for example guava, catch insect using a net. It's usually for monitoring. We can monitor the population of pests by using insect net. Sanitation from the pest source of decaying material. For example, if you have a guava that are decaying, so we can destroy it. Yeah, because the guava that has been decaying, inside the guava there are a lot of larvae, so we can destroy them. Sanitation from infected plants, collecting insect eggs or larvae and then killing them. Some of pests have a clump egg. Clump itu adalah berkelompok. Beberapa dari hama itu telurnya mengelompok. Jadi kita when we have a clump egg, we can easy to control by hand. We can remove that egg and then we can destroy. This is the sticky trap. As I told before, there are many colors, but the most attractive is yellow one. This is to control the aphid, kutu daun, and thrips. So they will stick into this yellow sticky trap, and this is the wrapping method. This is the rain shelter. This is the crop isolation too, but adapted to the local needs. Well, in Netherlands, they have a full cover netting, like in these pictures. But in Indonesia, we can adapt to the local condition. This is how IPM works. Collecting insect, as I told you, the egg of the pest, they clump. They together, and if we destroy this egg, maybe we can reduce the population before they hatch. Yeah, in this clump maybe over more than 200 larvae that can hatch from this larvae. So the mechanical measures is also important too. This is, I have a video, the link will also available on the Google Drive. Wait, we will see a bit. Maybe I will. This is the prop isolation used in Malang.
Fresh impact memfasilitasi peningkatan produksi dan
pemasaran sayuran
di Indonesia. Salah satu program Fresh Impact yaitu
the product is tomato beef. This is the location in Malang.
Usaha memperbaiki rantai pasokan sayuran dari petani hingga konsumen dengan intervensi setiap tahapan.
They work in this project. They work together with the government, with the Netherlands government. That's why they can produce the good quality
PMC
of tomato.
Kelompok tani tomat beef yang ada di Kota Batu, Jawa Timur,
they Jawa Barat, use more technologies to control the pest, from preparing the soil, how they use fertilizer.
Dikemas secara lokal, bekerja sama dengan trader regional, dipasarkan untuk pasar modern di Surabaya dan di Jakarta.
The target market is retail.
Rantai pasok yang menyeluruh serta dukungan dari Rexone, kami mengembangkan program atau PMC.
This is the tomato look like in the supermarket, tomato beef. And this is the grafted plants that can reduce this grafted plant is resistant to the disease. This is rain shelter. The rain shelter will reduce the disease in the field. Planting schedule is a good way training. As you know, in one of the principle in IPM, the farmer as an expert. So they should knowledgeable.
Respon mitra rantai pasok.
Pengalaman soal.
And they have a really nice good quality. Sorry.
Program saja soal penjualan produk yang dihasilkan.
This tomato look like the tomato in the Netherlands. It's really similar.
Jelas dari harga adalah kita mendapat.
This is how they grading their tomato.
Kualitas, kuantitas, dan kontinuitasnya itu sendiri.
Dengan kerjasama dengan
pek. And you should see by yourself in a video. Okay.
Kita bandingkan dengan produk impor karena fake impact.
They can compete with the import product because the quality is nice.
Dampak. Produk impor karena fake impact memberikan pelatihan dan pengajaran yang baik dengan cara yang modern namun bisa diterapkan petani lokal. Dampak. Bandingkan dengan produk.
Oke.
Impor karena fake impact memberikan pelatihan dan pengajaran yang baik dengan cara yang modern namun bisa diterapkan petani lokal. Dampak. PMC Tomat Beef ini berlangsung sukses. Kini, jumlah pasokan tomat beef di Batu
sudah dari 2 kali lipat.
Kelompok tani menjadi semakin kuat. Trader dan supermarket lain menunjukkan ketertarikannya pada produk tomat beef. Untuk itu, Fresh Impact akan menyusun protokol sehingga dapat dikembangkan di wilayah lain di Indonesia.
Nah, ini mereka kerjasama dengan Wageningen ya. They work together with Netherlands government. And the third one is biological. As you know, the biological we can use part predator. Predator is organism that can kill other organism. They prey other organism. And well, parasitoid is organism that can live inside the other organism. And we can use antagonistic agents for suppress the disease. For example, using piney bacillus polymixa. This is how parasitoid look like. This is parasitoid and this is aphid. And this adult parasitoid is piercing the aphid. They deposit their egg. So in this aphid, this aphid will be killed by this parasitoid. Yeah, the egg will hatch into the larvae, and then the larvae will emerge into the body host, and the larvae into the pupae, and then the pupae will hatch into the adult parasitoid, and then the adult parasitoid will fly to searching other prey. This is how their life cycle, and predator always hunt every day to fulfill their energy. And this is also biological. We can use entomopathogen. Entomo, it means insect, and pathogen is pathogens is agents that can make the insect ill. By using bacteria, virus, fungal, and nematode. So the insect could be ill by bacteria, fungi, nematode, and virus. This is how biological agents, so we can use predator, parasitoid, entomopathogen, etc. We can study more in the next lectures about the predator and parasitoid. And this also, I have a video for you. Buzzwake Agripore. This is how they use biological agent in orange pepper in the Netherlands. Yeah, I ever went to this incredible greenhouse, and they use biological agent such as like predator and parasitoid. They use environmental friendly. This is Adrefugia, how they conserve the natural enemies in the greenhouse. And they produce really nice orange pepper. And we can eat directly that orange pepper. Look forward to seeing you at Buzzwake Agripore. This is the biological agent that they use. This is the pollinator. Pollinator is bumblebee. Bumblebee is a bee that didn't produce honey. Okay, and it will help pollinate the orange pepper. And this is the predatory larvae to control aphid. And this is using parasitoid, egg parasitoid. So the parasitoid will hatch from this egg, and the parasitoid will searching for the host in the greenhouse. The biobase, this is written biobase. Biobase is a company that focus on a biological agents. So they sell, actually not only biological agent, but also they sell pollinator. It's different in our country. In our country, I think there is no big company that focus on biological agent. The big company still focus on synthetic like a pesticide, but no, we still couldn't find biological company that focus on biological agent in Indonesia. It's really different with within the Netherlands, and they also plant a grass. This grass is actually they have a flower, and the natural enemies use this refugia plant, yeah, to be a shelter, untuk pelindung ya, to be a shelter of the natural enemies. So after they hunt the prey in the field, setelah mereka berburu di greenhouse, or after the parasitoid is parasitizing the larvae, for example, they will come back into the larvae to rest, because they are also the organism, they still need rest. So we should provide a resting area in the field, in the greenhouse. This is me and my friends when in Bazwick Agriport. And when I went to when I go to there, I give a mark in here because I'm from Indonesia. This is a really nice greenhouse, and okay, I hope you can someday you can also go to the greenhouse in overseas. This is interesting. They produce, they actually not only produce orange pepper, but also they produce also tomato. The tomato that they produce, is the quality is also good. Yeah, like in the Malang, the video that we seen. And you know, in the right one, this is the tomato, but all of this tomato is they didn't use this. This is the tomato garbage. They didn't use this tomato. But you see, the tomato is still nice. The tomato is ripe greatly, and they big, but they didn't use that. What does it mean? It means that their quality of fresh product is really high. So if they meet the criteria that will decrease their quality, they will drown out the tomato. Yeah, it's interesting. Okay, because they always in Europe, and many people consume the fresh product. They only eat the quality which is perfect. And the fourth one is chemical control. In chemical control, we should make sure the five golden rules. We should make sure that we understand the label. What is the active ingredient? How is the dosage? How is the concentration? The second one is how to handle pesticide carefully. How to make the concentration? How to mixing? Yeah. How to mix? Yeah. How to spray you should make sure that we avoid to contact we avoid contact or contamination. Maintain sprayer well to avoid leaks. Yeah. Make sure that your sprayer is in a good condition, no leaks. Because if there is no if there leaks in the sprayer, it means that the pesticide will contaminate your body. And practice good personal hygiene after you use pesticide. What should you do? Cleaning and other. Always use appropriate protective clothing. Yeah, you should make sure that one, the clothing, to avoid the contamination. Monitoring, in IPM, we should monitor our field. We monitor like in we observe the pest and disease in a field. The sampling, for example, eggs or strips like that, or W. So we can know how is the population of pests and disease in our field. Should we use pesticide? Should we use synthetic pesticide or not? We can know by monitoring. This is the critical step in quantifying the potential damage that caused by pests and disease. And we can prevent how to control, how to manage that insects or weeds or pathogens. Okay, and I have a video game, and I will upload the link on the Google Drive, Google Classroom. Ulus Farm. Ulus Farm is this is Pak Ulus, and Pak Ulus he got FAO.
Yeah. Orang tua dan dari petani yang lain kan. Di sini cuma satu.
They got a FAO.
Masuk aja.
FAO
sertifikat. Sudah punya sertifikat sebenarnya ketina atau
misalnya. They can produce yeah. The good quality of crops by minimizing the use of pesticide and they use good fertilizer. He conserve the soil.
Hey, kan, yeah. Okay.
They make sure yang sustainable.
Pemerintah itu kenapa sih pemerintah agriculture untuk ke sektor?
Yeah, they got the appreciation kan, from FAO.
Bayangan untuk menjadi
in 2017.
Ya. Nah, pas bulan 9 minta sama Pak.
Oke, this is
bank 5 terbaik yaitu
the 5 achievement
itu ramah lingkungan.
Nih, from World FAO certification.
Rantai pasok itu, mata-mata rantai pasok.
And even they can sell their crops into overseas because they can comply with the requirement from other country.
Nah, jangka panjangnya yeah. Kita
they produce for example this baby buncis ya.
Makin subur dengan adanya kita mengurangi pestisida kimia atau pupuk kimia.
Yeah.
Nah, makanya saya selalu bilang
reduce the
subsidi pupuk ini hilang atau
chemical
setuju,
fertilizer and
stop subsidi sektor pertanian tidak akan pernah mati.
Okay, another this is me, and this is the right one. This is me. I ever be a course facilitator in a joint program from UNSIKA, and we together with Wageningen University and in the Netherlands, we work together with the farmers. Also from the facilitator from the Netherlands. This is also from Netherlands, and this is from UNSUD, and this is me. We work together. Also, I work together with Pak Widi, Bu Rahmi, also Pak Fauzi, and we work together with we made a course and we study about the food safety and integrated pest management. And one of our field excursions, we went to the Pak Ulus farm and we study there how they implement the good agriculture practices in their field. And this is for actually not for students, but it's for professional. Yes, my friends is come from, for example, this is Ajan from Nepal, from Bangladesh, and this is Paulus, the black one. This is Paulus, and from Nigeria, from India, from Bangladesh too, from Thailand, from Myanmar, and this is from Afghanistan. Okay, from India, another country. So this is a really interesting project I involve. Okay, and this is about the food safety and phytosanitary measures. And this is emerald analysis. This is from Afghanistan. You see, we analyze the maximum residual limit in lab kimia agro and horticulture packaging farm. And this is okay. And this is the institutional which make regulation in the field of plant protection. So we have many organization in a government, Directorat Pelindungan Tanaman. We have many institutional, Badan Karantina Pertanian, Komisi Pestisida. And this is in the local institution, in the local, in a provinsi, in a provinsi, in a kabupaten and kecamatan level, from Dinas Pertanian, Balai Proteksi Tanaman, and in the kecamatan, we have a UPTD, Unit Pelaksana Teknis Daerah. And this UPTD, they work together with the farmers to control the pests and diseases in the field. And this is in pusat and sampai in a village, ya. This is in a province level, in a kabupaten level, kecamatan, and in a village level. In kecamatan, we have a pengendali organisme penghutanaman or POPT. They was given full duties, responsibility, and rights by the authorized official in the agriculture scope to carry out pest control activities on plant. So, knowledge transfer is for the adoption of better control pest, integrated pest management. So in POPT, they help farmers how they implement the integrated pest management in the right way. This is the legal instrument. We have many legal instruments in the field of plant protection. So we have many regulation. For example, PP number 6, 1995, UU number 16, 1992 about the current quarantine plant, fish and plant, yeah. Another MPP number 7 is about how to surveillance the use of pesticide, how to save and how to use pesticide. So we have many regulation regarding pests and disease. And this is plant quarantine system in Indonesia. Plant quarantine, what is the purpose? The purpose is preventing the entry of quarantine pests from abroad into the Indonesia. Because, for example, in 2019, we have a quarantine pest. They are invasive pests. They are new pests that come from America to Indonesia in 2019. This pest is Sporoptera frugiperda, and it's attack the maize, and now in 2022 the population of Spodoptera frugiperda we can find in all over the territory of Indonesia. So the dispersal of this pest is really high and really fast. And also the purpose of plant quarantine is preventing the spread from one area to another area in Indonesia, and prevent the spread from the territory of Indonesia to abroad. So we make sure there are no invasive pests, there are no new pests that come from another country. What they do in a quarantine, in a plant quarantine, they do checking, isolation, observation, treatment, and after that, we will get a rejectment later or no. Because infestation of new pests is really have a impact in our environment. This is in quarantine pests. Some there are fumigation treatment. Fumigation treatment is pest control measures by means of process of release and exposure of fumigant. So we use fumigant. Fumigant is a gas. Yeah, there are four types of gas that are commonly used: methyl bromide, phosphine, sulfuryl fluoride, and hydrogen cyanide. But the most popular one is phosphine gas. In a fumigation, use RT chamber, berarti ruangan kedap udara ya, RT chamber, with a certain concentration, time, temperature, and pressure. And when we use fumigation, we should use respirator like this, because it's really danger to our health. So it's flammable, so we should use a complete outfit. Yeah. The purpose of fumigation is kill all types of pests, from eggs, larvae, pupae, into imago. This is actually for storage pests. Yeah, untuk hama godang. Also in bulak, in rice storage, we can use fumigation. This is GAP, good agricultural practices. Yeah, what is GAP, good agricultural practices? So in one of the GAP checklists is the use of less pesticide. Good agricultural practices are practices that address environmental, economic, and social sustainability for on-farm process and result in safe and quality food and non-food agricultural product. So we make sure that our food is safe from the field into the table. So we make sure that. So it's been that good agricultural practices. As the way to manage your system better to achieve this objective based on local condition, there are four gap pillars: economy should be beneficial, environmental should be sustainability, and social acceptable, and food safety and quality. So we make sure that in good agriculture practices, it's food safety and quality is good. Food if safe, you know that food if safe when food is free from biological contaminant, physical contaminant, and chemical contaminant. What is safe and quality food? The food which is the high quality food, that is food that conformance to the legal requirement, performance to the standard. The standard is high, and meeting the customer needs, and quality is not only meeting but better exceeding customer expectation. So we make sure that the quality is good. Okay, and we have two banana, the right one and the left one. The right one, the quality is better than the left one. The left one, this banana has been attacked by the caterpillar of Nacolea octasema. This Nacolea octasema only they border the skin of the banana fruit. Okay, so the customer should be choose the right one than the left one. And then it's about common rules in the gap system. So we should comply with the legal requirement. Yeah, the requirement should be all checklist from the using how the using of pesticide, using the fertilizer, using the seed and etc. Traceability is a plot and record keeping. When and how they use pesticide should be good traceability. And the third one is knowledge of integrated farming sustainability and knowledge of using pesticide, fertilizer, water, hygiene rules of for building equipment and personnel. And also in a gap system, the farmers can do the certification. Why we should implement good agricultural practices? Because our consumer expect the safe and the quality food, and our citizen want a clean and healthy environment. Worker want safe and healthy working, and farmer needs good soil and water in the future. New international market opportunities, because if we want to sell our product into the overseas, so we should comply with the all requirement that made by the country. One of the rule is how is the use of synthetic pesticide? Is that our product is the level of MRL is below or higher than the level. If below, the MRL is still good, but if the synthetic residue is above the MRL, so your product will be rejected by the country, by the other country. And this is the quality and food safety phenomena within the global context. We refer to the Codex standard. Yeah, Indonesia food standard refers to Codex. Codex is government agency in charge of implementing the joint FAO or WHO food standard program. And this is of one of the standard that should comply with the producer. And we in Indonesia we have SISAKTI. SISAKTI is a certification system of Indonesia agricultural product for fresh product, for example for fruit and for vegetables. In SISAKTI they are three prime three, prime two, prime one. The lowest one is prime tree. In prime tree, they are good record keeping for proper usage of pesticide. The prime two and prime one have many rules regarding good agricultural practices and good handling practices, and the quality is highest too than prime three. In prime one, all of the requirement is comply with the CCP system. This is according to the FAO, and it's based on the codex. So in the farmers can apply their product, so they will get a prime tree certification product. This is how the farmers get the prime tree. They should go to the testing lab to analyze the MRL and etc. And then the government will make a decision. The product will get the prime tree or not. This is the logo, prime 1, prime 2, prime 3. And this is the label of prime tree that Paulus get. Prime tree are presented to the farmers who has produced product food with the criteria safe to eat. And this is issued by Otoritas Kompeten Keamanan Pangan Pusat, OKKPP. And this is Paulus, and they got the FAO award. This is the prime tree certification. Paulus Pirmawan, Poktan Baby Friends. This is for Baby Friends. And this product is declared as safe and below the maximum residual level for 3 years, from 2019 and until 2022. This is the authorities who declare this certification, Ketua Otoritas Kompeten Keamanan Pangan Daerah atau OKKPD. Okay, this is how Paulus get the certification prime tree, and the prime tree label will be attached into his product. And then I think we finished today. Thank you for your attention. After this, we have a Zoom session. Don't forget to comment on YouTube, and see you on the in a Zoom class. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.